following episode is brought to you by the American Urological Association. The American Urological Association is accredited by the Accreditation Council for Continuing Medical Education to provide continuing medical education for physicians. For more information on how to claim CME credit or to view faculty disclosures, please visit the AUA University at auanet.org/university. Support for this episode has been provided by independent educational grants from Lantheus Medical Imaging and Novartis Pharmaceuticals Corporation.
Good afternoon. My name is Jay Rahman, and I'm professor of urology at Penn State Health and chair of the AUA's Office of Education. It's my pleasure once again to host another one of our Office of Education podcasts, with this specific podcast being in a series called Discussions in Prostate Cancer. It's my pleasure to host one of our guests who's been kind enough to offer up her time over many different events in many different years, Dr. Veda Giri. And our topic today is going to be the appropriate use of genetic testing. And we've sort of said who, what, when, and how. Just to introduce you, Dr. Giri is professor of medicine in medical oncology. She has a specialization in clinical cancer genetics, and she's the division chief of clinical cancer genetics at the Yale School of Medicine, as well as being the director of the cancer genetics and prevention program at Yale Cancer Center. She's also the director of the new early onset cancer program, and has really been a thought leader in this space for a number of years, and is always, as I mentioned, very generous with her time in giving us some of it on our program. So Veda, as always, delightful to see you. A huge thanks for your time.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here.
So maybe before we sort of dive into this topic, why don't you just give our listeners the high level of view of what we're going to be covering, and then we'll just sort of go through and maybe just, you know, tackle some of the different nuances involved with genetic testing.
Sure, happy to. So this particular discussion is going to focus on the germline genetic testing, a rapidly evolving, very exciting field in the space for prostate cancer. So we're going to cover three main learning objectives when it comes to this. One is to talk about how do we identify patients and populations that should be considered for germline genetic testing, and what are the factors that go into that consideration? The second is the thinking about integrating genetic testing into clinical practice, and what are some of the considerations there? And then third, how do we utilize this information for clinical decisions and management plans, whether that involves treatment or screening, and also for patients and their families?
Right. Yeah, that's really super. And I think it's I think the way you've structured is so good, in that it's sort of like, who should we do it? How do we actually put that into practice? And then, you know, what is the impact of it? How can we actually use that to impact in a good way patient care? So let's start with the first of these. You know, you sort of talked about, you know, prostate cancer, who should be considered for genetic testing. Kind of give us the broad framework of, you know, where are we with regards to genetic testing for prostate cancer? Where are, you know, some of our gaps? I think it's probably one of the areas that urologists have the greatest amount of opportunity, because we see so many patients at early diagnosis, and we probably need to do better jobs of identifying who would benefit and frankly, executing on that. And then what should we be testing for? Like, what genes are there, and you know, how does all that work? So maybe walk us through that first part.
Yeah, absolutely. So, this has really become a central part of prostate cancer care or risk for individuals who don't have a diagnosis of prostate cancer. And the field has substantially grown in terms of thinking of the genes that are associated with prostate cancer or could be informative for the treatment of prostate cancer. So these days, we can actually test multiple genes at one time when we are undergoing genetic evaluation for a germline genetic evaluation. Some of the key genes to keep in the front of mind when we're talking about germline genetic testing are number one, BRCA2, a very, very important gene when it comes to prostate cancer for a number of reasons. This gene has a strong association with prostate cancer risk and also with aggressive disease, and also has now multiple treatment implications, particularly in the advanced and metastatic setting for therapeutic decisions. BRCA1 also has association with prostate cancer risk. It's somewhat lower than for BRCA2, but it does have treatment implications. Though what we're going to see as we talk about several other genes is that there's more to be learned about the full clinical outcomes of, you know, let's say, PARP inhibitors and, you know, treatment of prostate cancer with the various genes. Another gene to keep in mind is HOXB13, which is a hereditary prostate cancer gene, strongly associated with prostate cancer risk, and also has a lot of data to support earlier development of prostate cancer, so early onset prostate cancer. So could have screening implications in that space as well. But really, we can test multiple genes now when we do germline testing. And several of these genes are actually DNA repair genes. So that pathway is really important to keep in mind when we're thinking about genetic testing for prostate cancer. These different genes have variable associations with prostate cancer, variable indications for treatment. But to your question, Jay, about, you know, what can urologists do and where are the gaps? Mm-hmm. I think one of the biggest things to keep in mind is that urology really serves now as a gateway to thinking about genetic testing for prostate cancer. So really critical to bring this, form to the urology setting. And basically, when we think about which patients to therefore test for genetic testing, the current NCCN guidelines really think about this in sort of, we can think about it in a global way and then some more nuanced indications. So globally, any male with metastatic prostate cancer should be offered germline testing. Anyone with higher risk features as well, higher stage, higher grade group, should also be offered germline testing. Furthermore, anyone who, where there's a treatment indication, sort of systemic therapy decision-making that would be impacted by the germline results is also a huge reason for germline testing. Beyond that, so for men that have lower risk prostate cancer or for men who don't have a prostate cancer diagnosis, but thinking about this from a risk standpoint, it goes into the family history criteria. So here we're thinking about family history of not only prostate cancer, but remembering because these genes are linked with various cancer types, we have to be broad when we think of family history. So it's family history of prostate cancer, breast cancer, ovarian cancer, pancreatic cancer, uterine cancer, and how many relatives are there with those cancers? So the guidelines lay that out in terms of, is it a close blood relative, like a first degree relative, brother, father, sister, mother, et cetera, or is it more expanded in the family when we think about more distant relatives, but could still help a man qualify for genetic testing as well? And then we also want to factor in ancestry information. We do ask about Ashkenazi Jewish ancestry because we recognize that BRCA mutations can be at higher rates in those individuals. So I think in urology, it's really thinking about which patients meet criteria for genetic testing. I think we're going to learn a lot more about how that can influence really important decisions in, you know, the management and treatment as we go forward.
And maybe just to sort of close out this story as we're trying to, you know, look to educate maybe urologists and urologic practitioners, talk to us just briefly. You know, we've got germline testing, and then I think what we also see a lot is looking at genomic classifiers. And we obviously, we see those maybe in the setting of a patient who's at a biopsy and you're looking at different gene expression classifiers to maybe give you a sense of surveillance versus treatment. We have the same sort of model, maybe post-prostatectomy, and maybe even looking to look at radiation therapy and guide duration of ADT. So maybe talk a little bit about germline testing versus sort of the second distinct concept, which is sort of biological behavior based upon, gene expression classifiers.
Yeah, that's a really great question. And you're right, it comes to education of providers and patients, because patients can often come to us and say they had genetic testing, but what they actually had was gene expression or classifier testing, you know, or they may have had somatic tumor testing, you know, NGS testing as well. So, so it really becomes a point to clarify here. So when we're talking about germline testing, which is the focus of our conversation today, this is really talking about inherited cancer gene testing. So we're really looking at a set of genes that are cancer genes that are where mutations can be inherited. And that information, the knowledge of that information can be helpful to think about what's the risk of cancer in a person's lifetime. If they already have a cancer, what is this going to help them with in terms of management of that cancer, treatment of that cancer? Are they at risk of additional cancers? Because again, one person with a risk of prostate cancer could also be at risk for pancreatic cancer if there's a BRCA2 mutation. So what can we do about that? And then also thinking about this from the hereditary cancer perspective, what does this mean for blood relatives? So cascade testing really then comes into play. The gene expression classifiers have been in the urology field for a very long time now. And so those are distinct tests that really help to determine or predict the risk of cancer spreading, metastasizing, the behavior of the cancer, to help the physician have a discussion with patients about the intensity of their treatment or strategies for their treatment. So they're very distinct, and that's not inherited in nature. So just really a good and important discussion point to keep in mind and about the clarification about these different types of tests.
Yeah, I think one of the points you made is so accurate, because I've certainly had my own patients who, when I talk to them about, have you had genetic testing? The answer is, yes, I have. And what they'll end up pulling out is essentially information from one of the genomic classifiers. So you're absolutely right that it's not only education for practitioners, but to your point, it's actually educating the patients as there is a difference. And obviously the two are distinct, and you're asking distinct questions, and you're hoping to gather distinct information. So I think you really articulated very well who should get it. Obviously you walked us through the NCCN criteria, and we've talked a little bit now and in the past about, you know, how as gatekeepers, urologists, and urologic practitioners can have such a valuable role in helping accomplish this. So then the practical part of it becomes how. How do you do this? And maybe talk to us a little bit about, as you talked about how to do this, I'm sure the how to do this is different if you're at Yale Cancer Center, if you're at Penn State College of Medicine, where you have a built-in perhaps infrastructure, and those may not be wholly applicable principles if you go into more community practices, more rural environments. So just as you sort of walk us through how to do this, maybe if you can touch on the different scenarios and being in a resource-rich versus maybe a less resource-rich environment.
So great to think about it in that way. And, you know, one of the starting points is for practices in general, when thinking about implementing genetic testing or the discussion of genetic testing into their practices, is to really think those things through. What are the resources that we have available? Where are our local cancer genetics programs? Are they there? And if they are there, how do we have these discussions proactively with those cancer genetics programs to say, what are we going to do in our clinic or in our practices? When should we send patients to you in cancer genetics for at the right times? Which patient scenarios? And really kind of delineating those workflows ahead of time is really very, very important. And so really one of the classic ways to think about implementing genetic testing is identifying patients in practices, and then if there is a cancer genetics program, is referring to cancer genetics to handle the pretest genetic counseling, and the genetic counselors would discuss the various different aspects of what it means to have an informed decision for genetic testing, and then go ahead and proceed with genetic testing and the return of results. The reason that this space has become really important to think about what is actually discussed before genetic testing is because this can have implications on if a physician's practice wants to do that part of the discussion with patients. So what is discussed in that pre-test counseling time are things like the nature of this genetic testing, that this is hereditary cancer genetic testing, the importance and collection of family history information to help determine the extent of the genetic testing, and really thinking down the line about further recommendations for the patient and their families. What are the types of options for genetic testing? Do we want to test a small set of genes? Should we test a much bigger set of genes? Because we can test as much as 100 genes these days. What are the pros and cons of doing that? You know, what are we really going to learn? What's actionable? How many, what's the chance of finding something that's uncertain and doesn't impact management? How will the patient receive this information? Do they want only something that can be acted upon now? Or are they just much more interested in knowing from an academic purpose, you know, and just knowing everything? Discussion of what are these different types of results and how it can impact the management becomes, you know, really critical. What about any impact on insurance discrimination becomes a really big point to bring up. So, you know, there is a federal law called the GINA law that is in place that protects people who have genetic mutations from health insurance discrimination in most insurance plans, but not every plan is covered by the law. Employment is covered by the law, so employers cannot make decisions about hiring or letting people go or anything like that based on mutation information. Except small businesses are not part of the federal law. So there are a few of these gaps. But what isn't covered, the big one is long-term care, disability, life insurance is not covered. So when there are these issues that come up, if a person is otherwise healthy and has no pre-existing conditions, these are important topics to talk about such that they can properly sequence their genetic testing with their financial plans and insurance plans. But these are things that patients need to understand before stepping into genetic testing. So this is what genetic counselors talk about, and that still remains the gold standard in terms of working with genetic counselors. Now, what we are recognizing is that the patient volumes have absolutely exponentially grown who need genetic counseling. So it's just not sustainable to refer every patient to a genetic counselor in most areas. So what we do then talk about is what are some ways that we can adapt this such that urology practices could actually start to implement more of this genetic evaluation in their practice. There's a lot of studies that are going on, some of the studies that we've published on, so that utilizing digital tools to help deliver this pretest information. And most of that work has found that that is not inferior to having a genetic counselor discuss this information to patients, as long as the right patient is chosen. Some patients have high anxiety, really do need to see a genetic counselor. So, but for the most part, it helps to mainstream some of that pretest discussion to urology practices. And then really thinking about, you know, once genetic testing is conducted at a reputable laboratory, making sure that the choice of the lab is an experienced lab that will report these results and update any uncertain findings, is which patients to then send to genetic counselors. And for the most part, those would be patients with genetic mutations or pathogenic variants or likely pathogenic identified. The other part of this is, so that's one way, and that's considered more point of care testing now, where the actual testing is initiated in the healthcare provider's offices. We're trying to mobilize that actually a lot more here at Yale Cancer Center and Smilow Cancer Hospital, because even within an institution where there is a robust cancer genetics program, the volumes are very high. And also, it's very convenient for the patient when they're there in the office to talk about genetic testing. So we're really trying to make it more accessible. We're also building out other models within our cancer genetics programs, like coordinator-based approaches to basically we've developed a fast-track program such that the patients can get expedited evaluation and genetic testing within our program to meet the needs and demands of the patients. So I would say really key is build these, have these conversations proactively. And then that way you'll know how to build out your workflows to address the needs that you have for your patient populations.
So three, I'm going to ask you sort of three, I think, you know, fairly simple, but maybe practical questions that patients ask. And certainly I feel that when I talk about genetic testing, these are the big three that I'll get. So I'll just sort of field them to you so that maybe you can help educate our audience. So the first one that I often get when I have these conversations with patients is, how is this done? Like what do I have to give? Is this blood? Is this urine? Is this a cheek swab? So, you know, just broadly speaking, when a patient, we're talking about genetic testing, what are we testing?
Yes. So this genetic testing, which is the germline genetic testing, mm-hmm. can be done on a blood sample or a saliva cheek swab sample. So simple, you know, simple testing to be done from the standpoint of the sample itself.
Perfect. Question two that I feel like comes up very commonly is, does insurance cover this? So yeah. maybe you could just sort of broadly field that question.
Yeah, absolutely. So most of the insurance plans are going to follow the NCCN guidelines to determine their coverage of genetic testing. However, even with that, there is a lot of variability for genetic testing coverage. Now, the key though is oftentimes to overcome that variability requires some extra steps in the process, like pre-authorization and, you know, giving support as to why this patient meets national guidelines and needs the genetic testing. But for the most part, yes, genetic testing is covered by insurances. On the patient-by-patient level, there can be some variability, and that does need to be discussed with patients, you know, as we go forward. I will also say that out-of-pocket payments for genetic testing have been much better over recent years. You know, it's come down from thousands of dollars to, you know, typically about $250. However, even that landscape is changing. So we can't always just rely on saying that out-of-pocket is a flat fee of some sort. There's some laboratories are shifting some of that as well.
And then I think the third question that often comes up is, and I think you've alluded to it, that you can sort of have three permutations of results from genetic testing. Positive, so you're positive in the array of a gene mutation that's related to the disease, say prostate cancer, that the patient is presenting. Negative, which is, you know, perhaps the easiest in that all the associated genes are negative. And then I feel like the one that sometimes creates some some agitation and concern because it's the great unknown are these mutations that have unknown significance, right? So it's not related to your disease as we know it right now in 2024. But at the same time, we are picking up something that is mutated. How do you sort of counsel patients on that third entity, which is the, we don't really know what this means right now. It may mean something. We just may not have studied it yet. How do you counsel patients on that?
Yeah, that becomes a really important point to discuss ahead of time with patients, because with the multi-gene panel testing, about 30 to 35% of patients will come back with a variant of uncertain significance, also called VUSs. And so therefore, just to be prepared that if that is the result that comes back, what does that mean? So these variants of uncertain significance are basically in a gray zone. They don't meet enough criteria to be classified as pathogenic or likely pathogenic variants / mutations. And they're not low enough on the scale to be just called benign. And we mm-hmm. all have millions of benign variants, you know, in our genomes. So the labs report them out as these uncertain findings. What patients need to understand is that these variants of uncertain significance are not factored into clinical decision making at the time that they're reported. So further decisions about cancer screening or treatment is all based upon their personal medical history and their family history. What does happen, though, is that the laboratories track the science, the literature, the data for these variants, and over time, they may come back and say, we know more. This was previously uncertain, and now we think this is a mutation, or this mm-hmm. is likely pathogenic. If that were the case, they issue an amended report to the ordering doctor or ordering genetics provider. And then the ordering provider needs to reach out to the patient to say, we need to talk about recommendations. This was reclassified. So patients also need to understand that there may be a change in the interpretation of this as time goes by. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, an important piece to keep in mind. The other thing just to bring up really quickly about, since we're testing many genes these days at one time, is that we may find a mutation in a gene that's considered an incidental finding. And that can also be very surprising and hard to take in for patients is I came in for prostate cancer genetic testing, but now you're telling me that I have a risk of pancreatic cancer. And so this is some of that pretest discussion to set the stage for results that could come back so that patients aren't blindsided.
No, that's very, very well said. And then maybe the last question I have for you and some of the stuff we just talked about is these digital tools, the ones that help you maybe facilitate point of care testing. I think you have a lot of experience in this. Are these proprietary to institution? Are they available? Like, how does one actually use one of these digital tools? You buy a subscription as a practice or as a university to a certain vendor? Just give us a sense of like, how do you incorporate this? How do you actually tap into that as a resource?
Yeah, this is a great question. And actually, we are actively now trying to work with one of the national organizations to make some of these tools available to the public so that providers could even just, you know, look on this website, you know, say, oh, I need this type of a video or I need this patient-driven tool, and then understand how to incorporate that then into practice. So, for example, let's say it's a video. It's a 7-minute video that talks about all of these points for genetic testing. The clinical team could say one of our clinical team members is going to discuss and show you a video, you know, about genetic testing. We'll answer your questions and then we'll get the genetic testing going. Or before their next visit, I'm going to send you a link to a video. Watch this video when you come in. Let's talk about it and then order genetic testing. So it's kind of a way to do this in a more flexible way with these digital tools. But please stay tuned because I think we're going to have a lot of these much more accessible without a cost, we're hopeful, and also, you know, available to the public.
No, that's great. Yeah, you know, to the points you make, you know, we are all under so much pressure. You know, you've got to see patients every 15 minutes, 30 minutes for a new, and you think about all the things that need to occur in that visit. And so having the opportunity maybe to get these resources to patients before they walk into the office, I think probably gives them the ample opportunity to actually digest it in a way. And then the other part of it, truthfully, is it probably in some regards standardizes the messaging, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what you present and maybe what I present and somebody else presents, those could all be different. And one wonders whether sort of a more standardized platform just allows a more objective way of presenting this information. So, you know, so patients can make, you know, the best decision, I guess, for themselves.
That's a great point. Absolutely. Standardizing the information. And it also comes back to a point you raised earlier about resource limited areas. So in these types of settings, these tools can help to bridge the gap in some of for a portion of those patients where they could have this done and then connect with their, you know, urologist or primary care doctor or however that's happening. And then even with that link to cancer genetics, there's more telehealth services now that are also being done. So these technologies are really, we're trying to bridge that gap.
So we've talked so far about, you know, the guidelines on and how we as you know, global medical community, but especially urologists, urologic practitioners, how, you know, we can really make a better impact in tackling this. You gave us a really nice summary on some of the practical aspects of implementation. So then the third part of this is, okay, what do I do with this information? How is this going to help the patient in front of you? How are we using this in the realm of prostate cancer to personalize treatments? And then obviously, I think you briefly alluded, but, you know, the sort of the downstream of impact for familial reasons and sort of the concept of cascade testing. So maybe talk to us about how do we use this information to improve or inform upon care pathways, personalized care, elements like that.
Yeah, absolutely. So this has really been, I think, the biggest areas of growth in terms of thinking about the role of genetics in prostate cancer care. The space where it has really impacted and is continuing to is in the metastatic setting. So for men that have metastatic prostate cancer, as I mentioned above, there's that blanket indication for offering genetic testing. And the reason, one of the big reasons for that is for men who have castration-resistant prostate cancer, multiple targeted therapies are now FDA approved and have indications for treatment of these men at various time points in the spectrum of their care for metastatic disease. And you know, it's become actually pretty complex very quickly because these drugs have different indications in different genetic, you know, mutation criteria to qualify for the use of that those drugs and along the spectrum of the care of metastatic disease. So, you know, the big group of drugs to keep in mind are the PARP inhibitors. Mm-hmm. You know, these drugs are really important in this setting of metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer. They have different indications at different, as I mentioned. So, for example, olaparib can, for men that have had no prior treatment or those men that have had, you know, only prior docetaxel but no prior novel hormone therapy, is only indicated if they're BRCA1 or 2 positive, mm-hmm. but not for the other DNA or homologous recombination, you know, repair genes, can we, you know, use olaparib. But olaparib can be used in, you know, for men that have had progression on docetaxel or novel hormonal therapy. And there it's indicated across the spectrum of a group of, you know, hormone, of homologous recombination repair genes. So we see similar variability in indications for other PARP inhibitors, like, you know, talazoparib. Actually, talazoparib is indicated across the board for, you know, DNA repair gene mutations, except in the setting of progression on docetaxel and novel hormone therapies. But it's important to keep an eye on these indications. They're growing, they're changing, and there's lots more clinical trials that are going on. Even, for example, you know, pembrolizumab. So now immune checkpoint therapies coming onto the scene for patients that have deficient mismatch repair. You know, what there's indications now for the use of pembrolizumab and other drugs for in the, particularly on clinical trials. So this is a very active area, and it's rapidly growing in terms of giving men more options for treatments once they've progressed on various therapies. The other space, of course, where the genetics can be important is for men that don't have prostate cancer, mm-hmm. and thinking about how should they better screen for prostate cancer. Mm-hmm. And so here, the current guidelines, the NCCN guidelines, do list several genes. And the strongest one to think about starting prostate cancer screening at a younger age is for BRCA2. Mm-hmm. So for those men, to recommend, you know, prostate cancer screening starting at age 40. And to consider this for mutations in the other genes, BRCA1, ATM, CHEK2, as far as the current guidelines go. Now, again, it's really important to continue to keep an eye on the clinical trials that are going on, screening trials, because we may learn more about what the aggressiveness of the prostate cancer that's being detected, mm-hmm. the, you know, outcomes of these men who are undergoing screening, so that we can actually refine this as we go forward as well. So a couple of the studies, the NCI has the screening study for men who are at high genetic risk that is ongoing, and that includes MRI in this process of PSA screening as well. So really important modality to understand better, you know, how MRI fits into all of this. The PATROL study as well, which is going on, which is more physician directed, but also if clinically indicated, MRI could be done too. So I would definitely keep an eye on a couple of those, you know, studies that are going on. And, you know, you mentioned about the cascade testing, and, mm-hmm. and this is really, of course, comes back to the hereditary nature of genetic testing. So one of the key thoughts is, even if for the patient themselves, it doesn't have an immediate clinical management impact, but they meet national guidelines for genetic testing, it really could be important to identify other cancer risks for that patient, because mm-hmm. let's just say they had low risk prostate cancer and they were treated. Our goal is that they're cured of that prostate cancer. So we have seen individuals then come back with other cancers who, mm-hmm. you know, didn't have their genetic testing, but had strong family history. So we have to keep an eye that other cancers can emerge in these patients. And then what do we do about that for family members? So, and this means for males and females, because the cancers can cross mm-hmm. into cancers that are relevant for males and females.
So maybe in the last few minutes, talk to us a little bit about, you know, equity with regards to cancer genetic testing. And, you know, obviously we talk a lot about differences in race and ethnicity with regards to prostate cancer diagnosis, prostate cancer outcomes. But now we sort of have this other element, which is genetic testing, access to testing. So maybe give us a little bit of a sense of where we are, where are the gaps, and is there any information on this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is just so critical because as we make these advances in medicine, whether it's genetics or in other ways, what we have to keep in mind is what about disparities? Who is not able to access these advances? Mm-hmm. And what do we need to do to bridge that? Again, another gap. And so a lot of the work in prostate cancer genetic testing has focused on how do we engage broad populations in this process? For example, we have data that is looking at, and this is not just from our institution, but across the country, whether it's clinical data or from trials, that there is a very significant underrepresentation of Black men in clinical studies and genetic studies. And so how do we learn more about what these genetic variants are in across populations? So from an equity perspective, this takes like a multi-pronged approach. And so one of the things that we did was lead a roundtable conference looking at how do we increase engagement of Black men in prostate cancer genetic testing. And we thought about this from the clinical perspective and the research perspective. And ultimately, it comes down to all sectors of society need to think about this. So whether it is the doctors and patients, community and advocacy organizations, patients' families and support members in the communities as well, enhancing policy to broaden coverage, for across insurance plans, and to think about this from also a public messaging perspective. Mm-hmm. So to raise the awareness of the public. It takes partnership across the board, from academia to community clinics and also to community advocacy centers, as well. So this paper was just published. And so it is, I think, something that we thought was an important contribution because it points to the need that at any point, wherever we all intersect in this, we can think about how do we raise awareness and or build processes to increase equity and engagement for broad populations in this space of genetic testing.
That's great. No, very, very well said. Well, Veda, it's always a pleasure hosting you. You're really your passion in this space is palpable and infectious, frankly. And I think the way you sort of summarize where we are and where we can go and what we can do in our field to do a better job in this space is very exciting. And as always, I know you have many things on your plate. I'm always grateful that you give us some time for these podcasts. It's enormously beneficial for our membership.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm always so thrilled to be back here. And I think this is just such important work and helps to spread the message as well. So thank you so much for having me.
For our audience, thank you very much for your time and your attention. Please visit us at auanet.org/university. Veda, I look forward to hopefully seeing you sometime soon.
Thank you. You too.